very sorry for my big grin. The quality of jokes keep decreasing here very, very fast-paced. The team is getting me out of my ball game here. And talking about games, we are currently still describing the playing field. So what we are currently describing is the crypto flower, which basically is the type of field we're going to play our game upon. So when we're talking about sports, you can either play indoor or outdoor. When we're talking about blockchains, you can either have a centralized or decentralized blockchain. Totally different ball game. Keep that in mind. So by describing the field, we are describing the crypto flower, we're describing the field. The players, the positions, and all the other things we will describe later on. We're currently describing how do the lines go, what are the limits, what is the rules of gravity, and all those kind of trade-offs. For now, second leaf, distributed systems. We already discussed proof of work in previous session. Important to realize is that one of the downsides of proof of work is that it's of course inefficient. It's done deliberately and it's very costly, also done deliberately. Because it's very costly, the security increases as well. So most likely sending Bitcoins on the core layer will never be cheap because you need to pay miners for security. If it's very cheap, then the security might be cheap as well. So people start to figure out, okay, maybe perhaps I need to tweak the field because I want to play a different ball game. So instead of going outdoors, we now go indoors. It's the exact same with proof of work, with proof of stake. Proof of stake is a totally different ball game. The main goal, having fun, having a use case, etc. for sports, we have the same main goal with proof of stake, reaching consensus. We still have a distributed ledger that needs to reach consensus. But this time we're not using random numbers and a lot of energy. This time we're doing it differently. This time we have, for example, let's say we have 10 miners, or sorry for that one, not miners. When we're talking about proof of stake, we talk about minters. And we mint coins, we don't mine coins. So proof of work is mining, proof of stake is minting. And they need to put skin in the game. So proof of stake, you could also call it proof of skin in the game. So each of them puts in 100 of their tokens. So every time, these concepts of the blockchain are still the same. We're still hashing transactions. The only thing what we don't do this time, we're not going to try out different numbers. So not 1, not 2, not 3, not 4, not 5. You see where I'm going, right? This doesn't apply. We just grab transactions and we hash the block by creating a hash here and then connecting previous hash here by doing this. So that concept of Anders still applies. Only now you should think, hey, but how? Now everybody starts creating blocks because it's quite easy to create a block. Well, hold your horses. Everybody can still create a block, but of course other nodes need to validate it. And by being valid, you need to stick with the algorithm. If the algorithm says, okay, you're only allowed to validate a block if you have at least 100 tokens in your account, yes, then you're allowed. So everybody who stakes 100 tokens is now allowed to validate a block. That's one way to go. You could also say, let's just randomly select people. So let's make a big wheel of fortune where everybody gets a slot. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Like mentioned, I'm not famous for my drawing here. So blah, 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 all the way of 10, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Well, you see where we go. And then we just give it a big spin and then it starts turning, turning, turning. And then first block is allowed to be mined by mint or minted by minter, miner, minter number 2. And then everybody checks, are these valid transactions? Okay. Is the hash okay? Well, most likely it is because it doesn't need to start with 18 zeros anymore. So it's just a hash. And they check different other things. And then minter number 2 presents the block to all the other nodes. And then they check, Yes, it was indeed number two stern. So this is indeed a valid block. And let's do that again for the next session. So this one is equally distributed. Everybody has the same chance of being a minter. But what can you do if you have 2,000 tokens on your own? You can create, in this case, 20 accounts. So if you're rich, you can put up 20 instead of just being one, you now become 20. So there are 9 other minters and you. And all of a sudden, your chances went up from 1/10 to 10/29. You see? So your piece in this pie will, of course, be a lot bigger than previously. So if I now spin this wheel, it starts deepening. All of a sudden, my chances were 10% and are now almost, or bigger evenly, there were 10%, they're now more than 33%. So me minting the next page has increased based on the amount of tokens I have. So proof of stake is also one of the downsides, or one of the benefits is you don't need the energy. But one of the downsides here is that the rich are getting richer because they still get paid in the token that they for the token of the blockchain and the cryptocurrency of the blockchain they mint. In other words, miner 2 got, for example, rewarded with 10 new tokens and now could add those 10 tokens in his or her wallet. Important to realize, it's proof of skin in the game. So if you misbehave, your entire stake will be burned. Of course, these are 20 different public keys, 20 different addresses of which you use to mint. So only one will be burned. But still, you're betting way more tokens, 100 for the amount, let's say that you earn one token per minted block. Way more tokens that you can lose than that you can actually gain by cheating the system. You instantly lose the 100 by misbehaving. So of course, that's a very good incentive to keep you honest. But there are many other faults in this system as well, which we do discuss later on. We've added a few movies, a few short clips, I mean, explaining what is proof of work, what is proof of stake. What I haven't discussed though, still I see, is that Byzantine fault-tolerant systems, check that one. Byzantine fault-tolerant systems are just systems that are secure for the Byzantine general problem. So problems caused by the Byzantine general problem, distribution problems I've described before, are basically, if you're Byzantine fault-tolerant, if you have a good Byzantine fault-tolerant grade, you are very secure regarding these kinds of distribution problems. So let me check if we discussed everything. No, I need to discuss the final one. Delegated Byzantine fault tolerance is nothing more than, well, instead of randomizing this by a wheel of fortune, we now do something else. What are we going to do now? We're not going to use a wheel of fortune anymore. We're just going to say in advance, okay, there are 10 minters. And this block is going to be minted by number one. This one is going to be done by number two. This one is going to be number three. And therefore you appoint them in advance. So you delegate the power of mining or the power of minting to certain entities in advance. So this could be entities, the community trust, and you can, for example, let them be elected by the ecosystem, or let them be elected based upon their behavior in the past, or let them be elected by the algorithm or by the coding, etc. A good example of this is Neo, for example. They have 7 nodes running, where, or they used to, my information might be a bit outdated on that. A year ago, they had 7 nodes running, And every time one of these seven notes was appointed to mint the next block, which of course made it very fast, but as you now know, makes it also a bit less decentralized than, for example, a Ethereum or a Bitcoin. So a delegated Byzantine fault-tolerant system is where you appoint, doesn't matter how, but where you or an algorithm or the ecosystem appoints the next minter, sometimes in advance, sometimes at the moment. And proof of stake is where you basically put in the stake. If you behave correctly, you get the rewards. If you misbehave, they will burn down your house. Or in other words, they will burn down your tokens in that certain public key. And proof of work is where you need to add every time a random number. So for now, I'm going to wash my hands. I see you in the next slide where it's all about governance, the third leaf. If you think you want, or if you want to learn more about these many, many, many different types of consensus algorithms, because there are many different types of flavors, of course, within proof of work, within proof of stake, within DBFT, we will all discuss these later ones on. Keep in mind, of course, these are just applied regarding blockchain technology. If we talk about distributed ledger technology, there are even way more options. Think about tangles, think about centralized solutions, etc., etc. So the world is bigger than just these consensus algorithms, but these three are the most common we encountered during our research. If you know any awesome ones as well, and if you think they are suited for a basic element, basic foundation, or the blockchain basics, let us know in the comments. And we will, for now, hop on to the next one, the governance part.